building is 5 flowering rooms. And we'll kind of go in order right around the exterior hallway or corridor of the building. Right behind you here is room 1. If you put your glasses on or after I open and put them on, whatever you prefer. This room is 42 flowering lights, 42 of these 1,000 watt light bulbs. There's about 360 plants in this room. You'll notice everything is on these metal rolling benches. So what that does is gives us the ability to maximize our square footage. And rather than have walkways on the side of every row, we can have 1 3-foot rock walkway that we put kind of wherever we need it. And you can move the whole room at once or any individual row at once. So in all of the rooms you'll walk into, you'll see the same idea. It's these Gavita double-ended fixtures overhead. It's these GGS rolling benches, 2.5-gallon pots full of cocoa. I'll talk about our substrate later. And these Netafim emitters. And we'll talk about all of this stuff when we get to the dosatron components. But you can see where how we've really been able to maximize that square footage. We've increased our square footage our production space by about 45%. And when Pat's charging me based on the size of this room, that really helps. Early on, when the plants are young, we need them to veg. When we say veg, that means we need them to just grow. We don't want them to flower. And so the way that we do that is keep 18 hours of daylight on them. That tells the plants, hey, it's summertime. It's time for the days are long. It's time for us to grow. Once they get to a mature size and we're ready to induce the flower, we reduce the amount of daylight hours that we've given them down to 12 hours per day. And that tells the plants, hey, summer is ending, fall is here. It's time for us to produce our flower. So this room right here is 1 week into flower. We will harvest this room in 7 weeks. You're just now starting to see kind of the sites, the beginning sites of where the buds will form. In our other rooms.
How long has it been since these started?
Since I started? So when we get into the clone room, well, I'll tell you now and then it'll make sense afterwards. But the life cycle is as follows. I have a mother plant that you're gonna see on the other side, right? And I cut clones from that plant. 2 weeks later, that plant has roots. Then I plant that plant into that veg room, right? That veg room, like we just talked about, is 18 hours of daylight so that the plants just grow. They're gonna stay in that veg room for 3 weeks. So now we're 5 weeks in from the time I cut the clone till the time that the plant's about this big and ready to go into one of the flowering rooms. Once I put it in one of the flowering rooms, we'll reduce the amount of daylight hours. It'll start its flowering cycle. It will harvest exactly 8 weeks after. So from the time I cut the clone till the time I harvest the plant, it's 13 weeks.
So you could theoretically do 4.
And yes, if you're going clone to flower, we can actually increase that by having a veg space where we're producing all of the starts so that the flower rooms, right? When I come in and harvest this room, and we'll talk about that on the other side too, I'll harvest this room, I'll clean it all up, all in 24 hours, and I'll refill it from plants that are in the veg room that are already this big, and they'll go straight into that flower period. So these rooms can actually harvest every 8 weeks, as long as the veg room is doing its job to fill the flowering. So the reason for the epoxy floors, and then you can't see it on the walls, but this is a germicide and mildicide paint. And so when we come in and harvest the room, we chop everything down and we get rid of all of the old grow medium. All of this cocoa will go to the compost yard. It'll get turned into compost and resold to the landscapers. We don't use it ever again. And then we bring a crew in, we pressure wash the tables, we disinfect the entire room. And then the last thing that we do is spray a solution of bleach down on everything, the tables, the floors, the walls, a light solution of bleach. We wipe down all of the fans, all of the light fixtures themselves get all wiped down and cleaned up. And we plan to do all of that within 48 hours. So we harvest, we have 24 hours to get everything out and clean, 24 hours to get it kind of sanitized and disinfected. At the last thing we do to sanitize is we set off a couple of bug bombs in the room. And then the next morning when we come in, the room is clean and sparkling and sterile, and it's ready to be refilled. That eliminates any cross-contamination if you add any pathogens, molds, spores, or anything like that from the previous harvest. This is just a EC meter. So this allows us to test the water that we're feeding the plants. This will tell you how strong your nutrient solution is, what the temperature and the pH is. So this is hanging here just to back check. Whenever we're watering the rooms, the guys have in their standard operating procedures to go through and fill up a little cup with a little sample that's coming out and come over here and test it just to make sure that the dosatrons are working properly and that you're getting what you think you're getting. We'll go in the middle here at room two. So room two is so large that it has three doors for egress perspective from an egress point. So we're kind of entering into the middle of room two. It's the largest room in the entire building. It's 100 flowering lights. I'm PS Patients Collective. However, as California market is changing and as recreational, all of these things, you know, we're all trying to adapt and mold for the future.
Are all of your plants derived from the same mother then?
No. So we have about 30 different genetics, and this room has, I think, about 7 of them growing. And you can see right here, like a clear example of a defining line, right? This looks much different than this. And it is. It's because this is one variety, and that's a completely different variety. This is the largest room, but much like what I was saying in the other room, regardless of the size, all of those variables stay the same. I'm in the same size pots. The lights are hung at the same height. The fans work the same way. We feed the same stuff. 2 emitters per plant. All of those all of those constants remain the same. So the room gets bigger, but everything else looks, you know, more or less identical. All of these fixtures are daisy chained together. One of the cool things, this is the newest technology in lighting. These are Gavita lamps. They've been manufacturing horticultural lamps for a long time. They're a Dutch company. But this new technology gives you a little low voltage or Cat 5 data wire that runs from lamp to lamp to lamp to lamp. And rather than previously where you had to have contactors and relays turn lights on and off, we have these little controllers hanging on the wall. So all of these lights just daisy chain together, and then the last one comes and plugs right into a controller. And that controller has all of these cool built-in features. Auto dim, temperature shutdown, sunrise, sunset. So if it gets too warm in the room, the lights will automatically start to dim. And if it can't get back within the temperature range, it will kill the lights altogether. It'll send me a text alert saying, hey, we're dimming the lights are going off. I can jump on the cameras, see exactly what's going on. All of my thermostats in the building communicate through the network as well, so I can see exactly what's going on remotely. So very, very cool. The technology has come a long ways and allowed us to really, and going to like the dosatrons, we'll talk about it over there, but you know, the technology is great, and so we use it and implement it where it's feasible or viable, automate the things that we can, and then just redirect all of the man hours to, you know, the things that you really need to as these things scale up and as these businesses grow. You know, automation is definitely key. I'll show you room 3 before we talk about the dosatrons, just because the idea here is this is where those rooms that you were just looking at were 1 week into flower and needed 7 more weeks. These rooms right here are 4 weeks into flower and require, 5 weeks into flower and are only 3 weeks away from their harvest.
Oh yeah, I can see.
Much more pungent, much more pungent. So obviously, depending on the stage of growth or the plant's life, you know, if they're budding and getting closer to harvest, the aroma becomes much stronger. So we've implemented, of course, all kinds of different measures for aroma or for odor control. We've got a carbon filters, charcoal filters. And then I come to find out I didn't think we did, because Sal called me about this last week and I sent him over. We have a negative pressure system in here. So the idea is, rather than any air leaking out of the building, we're creating a negative pressure in the building so that we're drawing any leak or crack would be drawing air into the building. And that's to minimize the odor outside. This is what we call the dosatron station. And what this is our direct injection fertigation station. So dosatron is not new. Dosatron has been making fertigation components for a long, long time. a couple of things have happened that are allowing us to be able to utilize these kinds of components. One is that the size of the businesses, we've scaled up in a way that it now, we can justify it now makes sense to utilize economically to utilize these sort of things. Two is that Dosatron's been around for a long time. They've been supplying this equipment to cultivation facilities or horticultural facilities for a long, long time, and they would not touch cannabis for a long, long time. And now that we have licenses and we can show that we are bona fide businesses and whatnot, we have companies like Dosatron that are wanting to get their components into our facilities. So very, very cool. So what happens here, really cool, I can either hop on my smartphone, a tablet, or my laptop, or through the old school controllers, Rainbird controllers at the end down there, and I say water room four for 6 minutes. And as soon as I do that, the solenoid valve opens for room four, the pump senses a decrease in pressure, and rev up and start charging this line with fresh, clean water from these tanks. As the water comes through here, these are water driven, water powered, I'll go through and I'll set, again, depending on what stage of growth or what phase the plants are in, I'll say I need 10 milliliters per gallon of this, I need 30 milliliters per this, 10 of this, right? And I set my injection rate on all of those. And as the water comes through it, it powers and drives a syringe basically in there that's drawing up the appropriate amount of solution that I've called for, and it's mixing it in line. So this basically eliminates the idea of needing to mix any tanks, of needing to hand mix any nutrients. We just set it, we program for how long we're watering, the solenoid kicks on, the water power drives all of the injectors, and the plants get fed. This is the nursery or the veg room where all of the starts come from. So we talked earlier about as long as I can produce every time I harvest a room, if I have plants that are already mature, I don't have to wait for 3 weeks before I flip them in the room. So this is the veg room. This room will never have flowers. These lights will always be on for 18 hours a day, and these plants will always just grow. So a clone is just a snipping off of a vegging plant, like the plants that are in that room that we just walked through. It's as simple as taking a branch, cutting it at the right spot where there's what we call a node, dipping it into a rooting, which is just like a cloning gel, and putting it into this rooting medium. This is a rock wool rooting medium. And we leave it in this dome covered, this little greenhouse, for about 2 weeks until you'll see it start to pop roots. This is the dry room, and that's what all these trellis netting hanging up overhead is. And then it becomes the trim room. So the dry room, you know, is just these trellis nettings hanging, the rows of them, and the plants just hang. When we go in and harvest a room, we chop the whole plant down in its entirety. We don't take branches or anything. We take the entire plant and we'll hang it upside down. It'll stay in the dry room for about 10 or 12 days. Then it'll come off of the dry racks and go into the bins. And then that's where we start to process it. That's where we'll set the trimmers down here and they'll start to hand process everything. We are online now. The printer hasn't printed our first tag yet, but we'll be starting that shortly. And we'll be fully inventoried, getting all of our inventory into the database and getting every plant tagged in the next 10 days or so. So all kinds of components that went into a thermal printer that prints the custom UPC tags. And then the rolling carts with the scanners and that tie back to the scale. So every plant that we'll harvest, we'll have to scan the plant before we harvest it, chop it down, bring it to the scale. The scale will record the data into the computer.
With Mr. Kieley and the operators here as part of the life safety and fire protection to make sure all the flower rooms and all the corridors had proper exiting pathways. And there was some additional work required to create exit corridors. And then we reviewed all the sprinkler plans to make sure there was sufficient fire flow to ensure a suppression. Imagine a fire in a dried flower room. That's a lot of product on fire. And this building has sufficient fire flow to be able to suppress a fire in any one of those rooms or multiple rooms.
Several things. I mean, it starts from the outside of the building with visibility. I mean, you'll notice we cleared out all the landscaping, all the overgrown shrubs and things like that. And so the idea that
There's no real dark spots around the building. We light the buildings up really, really well at night. We've eliminated any little alcoves and things like that. And then of course, security cameras are extensive. We have about 48 cameras on the property here. All of them go back to a DVR. Burglar alarms, as well as panic buttons inside of the buildings. The employees have been trained. Some of them, managers, have key fobs on them that directly go to link to the burglar alarm, and then as well as a couple of remote hidden panic buttons in the building. So we're monitored through a burglar alarm system, through the cameras, the appearance of the building, and then of course personnel. We have security guards will be around the clock. This is a little different also than a dispensary situation. Yes, we have a lot of product growing in there, but guess what? Right now, I know what it takes to harvest that room. It's not easy. You need about 11 guys in 8 hours.
And really, so, other than your employees, there's no reason for people to be coming and going from this facility. Unlike a dispensary.
Exactly. We're not open to the public. It's not, any place that anyone who's uninvited would ever find themselves. And I think that makes, out from the outside of the building, it's clear too. We don't have signage, right? Because we're not a business that's open. But I think if you, had thought that you were coming to what was here before, a stone and tile place or something, I think if you thought you were coming there, it would only take a quick second for you to realize probably that you're not there. Yeah. So again, we don't own the property. So there was no initial real estate investment. So the amount of work is extensive, and the planning that go and engineering that goes into it. We've upgraded the service here to be, 3,000 amps of three-phase 208 power. The switchgear and the service upgrade, the customer responsibility alone was six figures. So it's a massive uptaking to bring all the infrastructure up to where we're needed. It was about 6.5-7 months of just full-on construction, and that ran simultaneously to us going through the conditional use permit process and the licensing process with the city. This building is about 9,500 square feet. Cultivation space is 6,500 square feet. That's of course how the city calculates their tax, and what we're gonna pay is based off of actual cultivation. So we got about 6,500 square feet generating and paying the city about $8,500 a month right now, and have been for the last 3 months. I was born and raised in the desert. I'm third generation Palm Springs, been here forever. My family's been here a long, long time. My roots are really, really deep here. So.
Are you related to the Kieley that the street is named after?
I am.
Really?
I am.
It's
my grandpa.
Your grandpa? Yeah, okay.
We're the descendants of Nellie Coffman. So I'm Nellie Coffman's great-great-grandson. Our family's been here since the beginning. I can't thank you guys enough for coming through. It means a lot to me that you guys, that we can be here doing this, that you guys have enough respect to show.